If malaria is being treated, that village developing an area in future is fine.
Hello there, dear viewers. It's wonderful to have you join us again for another edition of Covenant University eHealth series. Today, I have the privilege of having a very special person in the studio here. Very special indeed, and I'll explain why. His name is Dr. Anigbogu, and he is the Chief Medical Officer of Covenant University Health Center. Sir, it's wonderful to have you on the show today.
You're welcome.
Looking at some of your achievements here, I find out that I cannot possibly pronounce some of the things I see here. Can you please introduce yourself fully to our audience?
Good day. I'm Dr. Chukwunonso Anigbogu. I'm a medical doctor. I graduated from the from University of Port Harcourt in 2005. And presently, I'm a senior registrar in the Department of Obstetrics and Gynecology. I'm also the Chief Medical Officer at the Covenant University Health Center, OTA.
Thank you very much, sir. So it's exciting to have you join us today.
Thank you.
The topic before us is family planning. And I'm certain that a lot of people out there would have asked one question or the other on this topic. Some people are even thinking right now about this topic and they are wondering, what do I do? What is it? Please, can you tell us what exactly is family planning?
Okay. Family planning can be summarily defined as prevention of pregnancy, other than abstinence from coitus. What it means is that, just as the name is, you want to plan your family so that you don't have any complications, you don't run into risks. So family planning is a general term. When in medicine, we talk about contraception because that's a very important aspect of family planning.
Okay, may I ask the difference between family planning and abortion?
Okay, good. Family planning, it's when you're talking about child spacing or you want to control births, the number of births. But abortion is a different thing altogether. Abortion, you're talking about termination of pregnancy before the baby achieves the age of viability. As in before the baby can survive, achieve the age at which it can survive outside the mother's womb. Now, abortion in some countries can come under fertility control and family planning. That's in countries where abortion is legalized. So it can be a way of controlling the number of births. Maybe because the woman is not medically advised, is not medically indicated for the woman to be pregnant. So you can use abortion to control that.
Okay. So in the past, perhaps in the African history, the more children you have, the better. So, what exactly are the benefits of family planning?
Yes, family planning is not only beneficial to the couple. It's beneficial to the extended family, to the society, and to the country. Because if the family is well planned, a couple has the number of children they want who are well spaced, you are going to train your children very well. The limited finances you have will be enough to attend to them. Then you are not going to give the country headache in planning for the population. When you have population, because in some countries like India now, they have control measures. You don't give more than one, you don't give birth to more than one or two. They are trying to control the population. So if family planning is taken serious in this country, we achieve a lot. Family planning will help us reduce the rate of maternal deaths. There are some conditions that will increase the risk of a woman dying from pregnancy. There are some medical conditions. But when you space out these births, the woman will be able to recover from the previous birth and now will be ready to have a baby and go to, and be ready to go through the rigors of pregnancy and childbirth. Now, it also helps us to reduce infant mortality rates, because it's already confirmed that if the births are not well spaced, if the children are born without adequate spacing, there's increased fetal or neonatal mortality and morbidity. That is increased rate of death of the fetus or the newly born baby. So because of that, you can see how this is beneficial. And again, women who are up to 35 and above are at increased risk of maternal death when they get pregnant. But when you control the birth and you limit the number of children the woman will have, when the woman gets to 35, 40, there's no need of her giving birth to more, because you have been able to control that. And also an increased risk of congenital abnormalities, abnormal babies, when the woman is above 35. Mm. But when you don't space out these things, you run at a risk of having
there are some cases where a woman gets married late, and maybe above 35, and they're thinking, perhaps I should just rush all the children I can have quickly before I get too old. I mean, how do you deal with this situation?
Yes, that's good. Yes, they have a point, because, like I said, if a woman gets married after 35 years, of course, you want her to give birth to her children and complete her family, because she runs a risk of giving birth to a congenitally abnormal baby. Now, but you also will not want to sacrifice the woman's health status on the basis of that. So you have to weigh the two. One will tell a woman, you have to space out your births while you are still attempting to get. But we also advise her, try as much as possible to give birth to. Don't plan to give birth to so many children. Because you run a risk of giving birth to a congenitally abnormal baby. So what we do is that she still needs to space out, because you need the tissues to recover first before the woman becomes pregnant. That's what we call the puperal period. The tissues recover. You know, a woman gets pregnant, her body system changes. Yes. Everything, the organs, everything change. They need time to recover. And for some, it takes them as long as 6 months.
Wow.
So that's why we advise that the child spacing is very important. That's just one component of family planning. We're also talking about, the number of births, reducing the number of births.
Okay, sir. So now that you have been able to tell us the benefits of family planning, I'm sure our audience will be wondering the methods that are available. Now, what are the methods of family planning that people can consider out there?
Yes, we have various methods of family planning. You have the temporary methods and the permanent methods.
Okay.
Now, I know in the olden days that this method that used to be, that was the one that was popular in this setting, the natural method, where you don't need to take any drug, you don't need to take anything. All you have to know is that this is when I am ovulating. So I'll have to abstain from sexual intercourse. So abstinence. That method, that's what we call the natural method. Some people call it the rhythm method, some people call it the calendar method.
Okay.
Where you look at the calendar and say, okay, look at when I am likely to be ovulating.
Okay.
So I have to abstain from sexual intercourse. Or if I'm
going,
within this space of time, then that's a method. Then you have other temporary methods, which include the mechanical methods, use of condoms. Thank God today we have male and female condoms. Before it used to be male condoms, we have male and female condoms. Apart from mechanical methods, we also have use of esteroidal contraception, where we use hormones to prevent pregnancy.
Okay.
Then we also have intrauterine contraceptive devices.
Okay.
Then we also have emergency contraception. It's also part of it. I will explain all this. Now, we also have under hormonal contraception, is a broad term. I'm using it to include so many methods.
Okay.
Under hormonal contraception, you have the use of tablets.
Okay. Yes.
The oral medications, combined oral contraceptive pills, progesterone only pills. Then we also have the injectables. There are the 2 monthly injectables. Then there are the 3 monthly injectables, that is depo medrosy progesterone acetate.
Okay.
Then Presently, we have the injectables you take once a month. They are all under the hormonal method. You also have the implants. These ones also contain hormones. Some you put them under the skin, just beneath the skin. Some, for some, you have to go a little bit deeper into the skin. So there are all different methods. Now, but you also have the permanent methods. These permanent methods, what it means is, when you do carry out this procedure, the woman is not going to get pregnant.
Again.
Except when you reverse it. You can do some surgeries to reverse the methods, but the surgeries are not usually, they are not always successful. Yes, so that's why we call them the permanent methods. And there are two major permanent methods. You have this one in the woman and the one in the man. The one in the woman is called tubal occlusion. We don't call it BTL, you can't just say it's BTL. BTL is bilateral tubal ligation tying, because there are other methods of dealing with the tubes. Because the tubes, if the tubes are blocked, it means that the eggs that are released cannot have contact with the sperm that is coming up.
Yes, very true.
Then there's no ovulation. And once there's no ovulation, you don't expect pregnancy. But there are methods, we don't only ligate, we don't only tie the tube these days. That's why we don't call it bilateral tubal ligation. We just use the general term, tubal occlusion. These days you can use clips, you can even inject something that will solidify within the cavity and prevent the egg access or the sperm access to the egg. So in women, we have the tubal occlusion. Then in males, we have what we call vasectomy.
Okay.
There's a tube that conducts sperm to the outside. What you do is just to ligate that tube, cut it, and tie so that there won't be any link again. So even if the man is meeting with the wife, the sperm will not be coming out. And that one takes about 2 to 3 months for you to ensure that even in the emission the man is having does not contain the sperm.
Of course, this one also will be very difficult if peradventure sometime in the future the person decides to reverse it. Has it ever been done before?
Yes, it can be reversed. You can do surgery to reverse that, to connect the two again. But there are so different factors too. There are factors that will enhance the success rate too.
Okay, so what are the factors that determine the kind of method that a person can decide to use?
Good, thank you. You know, what the physician does here is not to make a choice for the patient, no. What the physician does is to provide education on these different methods, and then the woman will now make the couple now, not the woman, because the couple, you get the couple are involved, not just the woman. So the couple will make an informed choice. Now, there are methods, you have to educate them on each method. There are some methods, let's start with the tablets.
Okay.
The combined oral contraceptives, we also have the progesterone only pills. See, these pills, because they are hormones, they contain hormones. So there are some side effects. If a woman is hypertensive, she may not be a candidate for combined oral contraceptive pills.
Okay.
If a woman is having vaginal bleeding that has not been confirmed, you don't know where the source is, she's not a candidate for combined oral contraceptive pills. If a woman is still breastfeeding, she's not a candidate, because the combined oral contraceptive pills can reduce the quality of milk. She's not a candidate. So there are different methods. A woman is having migraine, this severe headache, she's not a candidate for that. If a woman has a history of stroke, she cannot take this. If the BP, blood pressure is uncontrolled, she cannot take it. So the same thing with the injectables. Maybe the 3-monthly injectables, we call it, our women know it as Depo Provera. That's the general name, but the real name is Depo Medrosy Progesterone Acetate. So what happens is that the woman after is given every 3 months.
Okay.
Now, ovulation may be delayed after 3 months. It may take 3 to 6 months for ovulation to occur after having the injection.
Yes.
So you wouldn't need a couple that will want to get pregnant immediately to have that. Because once after having the injection and the next month they cannot get pregnant, the one is that they will not want to continue again when they want to, and again they will go and discourage other other families from using it.
Why? Why prevent pregnancy beautiful. When you're ready?
Yes. So these are the things you have to look at. One, medically, is this person fit for this particular contraceptive? Then you also have to also look at other social factors too, even emotional factors. They're all considered. So that's why you have to address all issues. And you also have to listen to the couple. They will have to talk to you. You know, you don't just start the couple on any. No, you have. There has to be a meeting. That's what we do. There has to be a meeting. You meet with the couple. Then after educating them on all the different methods, then from there they'll be able to. They will ask you their own questions, their fears and everything. You're able to allay their fears. You're able to attend to their questions. At the end of the day, they will make an informed choice.
So what you're saying, sir, is that a couple cannot just sit down and browse the internet,
no.
read the options that are available and just decide to pick one?
No, it's not safe. You have to, first of all, meet your clinician. There are some, you know, we have to take history from you. We want to know about your medical history. We want to know about your gynecologic history. Then we also, a woman who smokes regularly cannot take some of these hormonal hormonal contraceptives. They cannot. So we need to take your history. We need to examine you. If you have a breast mass, you cannot take combined oral contraceptives until we know what it is. So we need to examine you. We need to do some lab investigations. Then we have to bring everything together now and say, okay, so that when you make that informed choice,
yes.
and we see that you are not qualified based on our findings, we also make that, present that to you too. So we don't advise couples to just take a decision by themselves without consulting their clinicians.
But how available, or accessible are these methods and even the counseling about it? Because I can just imagine what goes into it to have a couple sit down and discuss with their clinician. Do they really have time out there? I mean, I'm talking about clinicians with all the people around to attend to. Do they really have time to pay as much attention to couples? And then how available are these methods?
Thank you. An ideal contraceptive has some qualities, some features.
Okay.
An ideal contraceptive has to be widely available, has to be accessible. Has to be effective, 100% effective, should have no side effects and other things. Now, that's one of the challenges we are experiencing.
Okay.
All the contraceptive, no contraceptive has been able to meet these specifications.
As a none?
None.
Wow.
So there's no ideal contraceptive now. But what we're saying is we have a lot of options. Okay? So, and in this part of the world, in developing countries, they are not as accessible as they are over there. But there's something, for example, now condoms are available.
Yes.
The combined oral contraceptives are available and they are cheap, relatively. So quite a number of them are available.
Okay.
But there's something here. Education, awareness. How many people in Nigeria are aware that you have these? How many people have an idea about the side effects? How many people have an idea of where to go to even access these services? Now, secondly, you have a dearth of health facilities in Nigeria. How many of them do you have? Okay? When the government is thinking of citing health facilities, do they meet with the health, the leaders in the village? Do they meet with the women groups? Okay? You need to meet with the people you are citing a project for, a hospital for. They'll be the ones that will take a decision on where to site that facility. Because they are the ones who use this facility.
Use it, yes.
But that's what's happening in Nigeria. You just go and build one structure anywhere, and then you're making noise on the in the media that you build 20 hospitals. But are you sure that you've met the needs of these people? We are actually supposed to have family planning services. Clinics in
yes.
all health facilities.
Yes.
Especially whether the health facility is a primary care facility. And these services are actually provided by the primary health care staff. It's only when you're talking about the ones that require little surgery and all that,
okay.
that you now have to come to the doctor. But most of them are provided by the nurses. So what I would tell Nigerians is that family planning methods, quite many of them are available. In fact, all the ones that are available elsewhere are available. In Nigeria, and maybe in the primary, in the villages and all that, at least we know that the condoms are available, the pills are available, Even the injectables are available. But the government can do more. The question, what we're saying is, the government can make these things free. They're not expensive.
That's true.
Like in some countries, what they do is that they distribute these things freely. Once you come to see your doctor for something else, after that, the doctor will just, they will just cancel you immediately and provide these things for you free. You don't have to pay. So like what you're saying, in this part of the world where we don't have many, you know, that you see every year you hear that doctors are being churned out,
yeah.
Nurses are being churned, where are they? Many of them are leaving Nigeria because they are not well paid or they are not comfortable with the services and all the facilities. So we really don't have enough health caregivers in Nigeria. But we advise our people to go to the nearest health facility. Almost all the major health facilities have family planning services. So they are available. And it doesn't take, it may not take much for a couple to just bring out one day to go and see the doctor or to see the midwife and get education on the family planning methods.
But how about the side effects of this methods? Because we hear people talk about maybe someone is using this, it's growing fat, somebody's using it and reacting against it. So what are the side effects of this methods?
Okay, thank you. Every procedure is expected to have a side effect. Even by not using contraceptive methods, there's also a big risk. So what we're saying is that we're not, like I told you earlier, I said that an ideal contraceptive is not supposed to have a side effect.
True.
And I also said that there, for as at this morning, there is no ideal contraceptive has been found. But the ones we are using are very useful, and they have minimal side effects. When you have women complaining of having side effects, there's one question you ask them. Who provided education? Was there any education on this?
That's true.
Or you just decided to start maybe you met with a friend and she's using this, and you want, that's what they are doing, and you start using it. So that's the thing. If you are not properly educated on it, you are likely to make mistakes and then you have side effects. That's why I told you that when they come, after taking history from them, you have to examine the woman. You have to do certain lab tests, so they'll be able to know where they can fit in. So when the woman did not choose the right method, there's an increased risk of the woman coming down with side effects. Yes, I know some of them have little side effects,
yeah.
Like the tablet, the hormones, because they are hormones, so they can cause some changes. Yes, there can be addition of weight. Yes, if you are taking some on the tablet, but it's not that. It's one that it doesn't occur in all women. It's in just a small fraction, and the increase in weight is not that very significant. Some of these things are just psychological because they heard from other women that it can make you add weight, so they believe even when there's a little increase, they magnify it.
Yes.
And that's why these women should also be on follow up. They should be coming to the hospital. Some come 3 monthly and all that, so that you'll be able to check them. If you notice that they are having symptoms, you immediately advise that they choose
another method. So what you're saying is that contraceptive or this method should not be a once and for all thing.
No.
People should consistently come back for...
Yes, they should consistently come back to see their midwives, their clinicians for follow-up. Because they have to check you. Like if you're taking the tablets or the injection, the hormones, hormonal method, we check your BP, we estimate your weight every time you come. Okay, and we also check you for breast lumps or lumps anywhere. So they shouldn't just go home after the first day, after the day of coming to collect the drugs, and they will not come back again. They should be coming for follow-up, and I'm sure their midwives, their clinicians will always tell them to come back.
And then, sir, how about the challenges that have been faced as a result of people's perception of it? For instance, I know that there are some religious antagonism for family planning. There can be social, there are cultural challenges. So what are these reactions and how do you deal with this?
Yes, so these are some of the challenges we are having in this part of the world where you have you have cultural factors. Some people, people respect culture so much. So there are some cultural beliefs, there are some religious beliefs that don't support contraception.
Yes.
Okay, so what we do is that, one thing is that for you to to have a good response to this. You will not want to discourage people. You won't want people to disobey their beliefs and that all that. But you have to look for the ones that will suit them. Yes, I know there are some religious institutions that don't support certain methods. But there are still some methods that they support. Some people support natural methods. They don't want you to take anything. But you can just abstain from sexual intercourse when you are likely to be pregnant. Mm-hmm. And that's a good method. So we encourage that. And then we are now educate them on how to go about it. They reduce the rate of failures. And then you have some other cultural beliefs. Some people feel that, you know, like you said at the beginning of this program, that some people believe that if you have 12, 20 children, it means that you are very fertile. And, you know, some societies, what they do is that when you give birth to up to 10, they will kill a goat for you, you know. So all those things. But yes. So all we need to do to help enlighten our people is to educate them. Health promotion. In Nigeria now, I may not blame the clinicians much because we are still battling with the burden of the disease. We have so much people with a lot of illnesses we are treating. But let's also pay attention to prevention of diseases. Mm. That is where that's why other countries have overtaken us. That's what they are thinking of. In the UK, you don't have so many people battling to cure malaria because you don't have it. They've taken care of that one. Battling to cure postpartum bleeding in pregnancy and all that. They've taken care of that. They're now saying, what do I do to prevent women from having this? But we have not paid much attention to that. And that is why
we're dealing with the effects.
With the effects. That is why this topic, this family planning, is very important. It's a major intervention. It can help us prevent deaths in women, can help us prevent deaths among children. It can help the government to plan well. It will help in population control. So these are the things. So if you educate our women well, properly, if you educate them properly, if you take this message to all nooks and corners of the society, our people will become enlightened. That will help us to overcome these challenges.
So as we begin to round up this, I want you to please talk about the roles of men and women. For instance, I mean, they have different dispositions towards it. Some men just don't want any family planning method. And I mean, how do we deal with the role of men, women as respect to this? In respect to this.
Thank you. Especially men.
Yes.
Men have their own views. They have some views about family planning. That is why when we are talking about family planning, we don't encourage just one of them being there. We want the two of them to be there. Like I said, it's all about education. You know, you educate the couple, let them ask you questions. So the man will ask you questions. Because the man, it's not as if the man wants the woman to be in danger. But maybe she doesn't have he doesn't have the facts.
That's
so
true.
When you provide the education, the man will ask you questions. You will now know the reasons why the man has fears about embarking on contraception.
That's
then
true.
You allay those fears. Mm. So health education appears simple, but it's a powerful tool. Most of these developed economies have been able to solve certain health problems. Health education, but here we neglect health education. We think it doesn't mean anything. You push it to the primary health caregivers. You may not really educate the people well, and then you go away, go back to your clinic, you want to make money. But if the government will encourage health officers to go to the villages, you know, that's why we keep saying, I don't know why there should not be medical doctors, consultants at the villages. They don't want to go. All private hospitals are in the town because they want to make money. But the reason is, the government is not paying serious attention to health. Because government should empower them. Government should pay them more. There should be rural allowance. There's, you know, some things that's what they do. Go to Canada today.
To help them to
our people, our doctors, after going through the rigors of medical school,
yes.
They're all going to Canada and other countries. Because what they do is that when they go there, they don't push them to their towns. They push them to the remote areas to go and help enlighten their people and pay them well. So these are the issues. Our government should begin to look inwards. Okay, we have the doctors, the health, the nurses, lab scientists, so many people, health officers, who are experienced, who are qualified.
Yes.
But The government is not encouraging them. Our people are dying. The maternal mortality rate is so high. And the government is not taking the issue of family planning serious. There's nothing serious about it. They've not done anything. Our people are paying for condoms that you can provide, make readily available. Our people are paying for contraceptive oral pills. These things should be available everywhere. They shouldn't pay. So these are the issues. These are the issues we are having. So if we can be able to take care of these things, health education will help us allay the man's fears. You know, when you educate the man, then you'll be able to achieve the desired result. I've not seen any man who wants the family not to progress. I've not seen any man who wants the wife to die from rigors of pregnancy and childbirth. It's just because of lack of information.
Well, thank you very much, Doctor.
Thank you, sir.
And our dear viewers, I am very sure that you have a different perspective about family planning. I'm very certain that you have expanded your knowledge base. You know more about family planning. You know about why it's necessary. You know about the methods that are involved. You know that you should not just check the internet and follow the information there. You know that it's very essential that you meet with your doctor or your clinician who would advise you on what to do. And I'm very sure that you also learned that you just don't do it once and for all and go. It's important that you keep coming back for checkup. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you. It's so
good to have you here.
Thank you.
I'm sure that you'll have a last word for our audience, please.
Yes. Thank you, my people. As an obstetrician, we always show bias to women. So we want to plead to our women to please seize this opportunity to give themselves an opportunity, you know, a time, and you know, give themselves that benefit of that. Let them be the ones that will decide to live, decide to be healthy, decide to live for your children, decide to accept family planning. Come to the clinic. You don't need to go to the big hospitals. You can go to the maternities. There are matrons there. I mean, there are midwives there. They will educate you on this. Please see this opportunity to be able to give yourself better lives. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Doctor.
Thank you.
It's really been a great pleasure having you here. Understanding your busy schedule, I know that coming here is a very big job. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir.
So, dear viewers, thank you so much for watching this episode of the series. You should please look out for other topics that we'll be talking on or discussing on the platform of Covenant University eHealth series. My name is Lanre Amodu, and I say thank you very much for watching. See you next time.